Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's time to preach the word. Glory be to God. Oh, I give you glory. I give you glory. I want you to turn to the book of Ephesians. I want to teach you something. And I may need the team again, but let's see where the Holy Ghost takes us. Ephesians chapter 4. I want to welcome you to Divine Visitation Assemblies Online. We're called to take a people from bondage to greatness. We're called to raise up a wise virgin church ready to meet the bridegroom at his coming. And I want to read something for you found in the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Ephesians, hallelujah. Well, let's go to chapter 5, Ephesians 5. And it says in verse 18, it says, do not be drunk with wine. Do not be drunk with wine, wherein there is excess. But be what? Filled with the Spirit. It says, speaking to yourselves in what? Psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Now, what are psalms? Psalms are songs that already have been written. These are songs that praise the Lord. They are songs that exalt the Lord. So they are psalms. So a lot of our songs, what a mighty God we serve. In fact, all the songs we sang today were all psalms. All the songs we sang during the praise and worship were all psalms. Then there are also another set called hymns. Now, hymns are different. We don't sing a lot of hymns in church. Hymns are more describe the majesty of God. Okay. And hymns are, they're different. Hymns. Like, I give an example of a hymn. Let's start. Let's do a hymn right now. In fact, let's do a psalm for them. Come on. Woo! Let's do a psalm. We're going to do a psalm. Hallelujah. Because people need to understand this. I sense this in the spirit. Hey, we're going to do some psalms. Okay? Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. Woo. Now, there are psalms that are the psalms of rejoicing. So let's do a psalm of rejoicing. Huh? No, that's the easy one. Amen. But let's sing it. Take me higher, take me higher. Yes. Are you ready? Go! That's the psalm. Say, take me higher. Let's go.
Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher. Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher.
That's the psalm.
Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher. Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher.
Take me higher!
Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher. Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher. Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher. Take me higher, take me higher, take me higher.
Okay, that's the psalm. So, all these songs we sing, a lot of them are like psalms. Now, let's sing a hymn. And that is, hallelujah. That's a hymn. Let's sing that. See the difference.
Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns.
Woo!
Hallelujah.
Oh, yes. right. So a hymn is about the majesty of God. So hymns are majestic. There's a majesty that comes when you sing hymns. They're modern hymns. Now don't say the bishop said to sing hymns and don't go, Rock of Ages, clap for me. No, that is a hymn from the 1960s. Don't bring it here. Are you with me? The Bible says, sing unto the Lord a new song. So you need some new hymns. Okay? Hallelujah! So the people who are still writing new hymns, majestic. There's another song, there's a hymn. Forgotten. It's one by Darlene Sheck. That was written by Darlene Sheck, the lady from Australia, and also by Israel Houghton. That's the Lord is fighting. Many crowns. He's crowned with many crowns. Yes. Okay, you know it? Dun, 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 dun. Yes. Yes. Okay. That's a hymn. It's a very majestic song. Very majestic. Okay. Let's sing that part again. Let's go. Start.
God is fighting for us. God is on our side. He has overcome. Yes, he has overcome. He will not be shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus, you are here.
Okay, that's not it. Okay, that's a hymn. No, okay, that's a psalm. The one I'm talking about is Victor's Crown. Victor's Crown is a hymn. So this is a psalm. The Lord is fighting for us. The Lord is fighting for us. The Victor's Crown. That's right. The majesty of it.
Every high thing must come down.
That's right.
Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the Victor's Crown. You have overcome, you have overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown.
You have overcome, you have overcome. Yeah. And if you sing the stanzas, they're very majestic. So hymns deal with the majesty of God. And then you then have spiritual songs. We don't have much of them in church. So when I come up here, there's a grace on my life because I'm a prophet. I'm not a singer and I'm not a psalmist. I am a prophet. But by being a prophet, my spirit is able to access sound in the spirit realm. That's why I can say I can hear something. So right now in the spirit realm, as I said it, I'm hearing a drum beat. I'm hearing a march. So play that. I'm just demonstrating. So that's what I'm hearing in the spirit realm. My spirit is hearing that in the spirit realm. So when my spirit hears that in the spirit realm, my spirit will then hear the sound behind it. And I'm hearing a sound playing, and it's playing with the piano, but it comes in very sharp. Ding! Ding! Very sharp. So that's what I'm hearing in the spirit. Play it. Then in the spirit realm, I'm beginning to hear a song. Because I'm a prophet. So I'm hearing some words. That's it. Come on. This is what I'm hearing. I say stop, stop, no further. I say stop, stop, no further. Devil, you have come far enough. I I say stop, stop, no further. Come on.
I say stop, no further.
I say stop, stop, no further. Devil, you have
come too far enough.
I say stop, stop, no further. Come on. I say stop, stop, no further. I say stop, stop, no further. Devil, you have come far enough. I say stop, stop, no further. That's it. Now, if I wasn't going to preach, we'll stay here for the next hour. Katabashatabai. And one day we will. Because in this realm now, as I'm saying stop, I'm going to hear the next line. Then I'm going to hear the next verse. Then let me tell you, we're gone. Jesus. Because from the spirit realm, the spirit realm is always speaking. The realm of heaven is always what? Speaking. So from the realm of heaven, there is music coming. There is sound coming. There's words coming. So all I did is I accessed it. Now my team, they are exceptional because I'm not a singer. So they need to have very good memories. So when I start, they have to remember it on the first go. Hallelujah. So they have to remember it on the first go. And they remember it on the first go. And there we go. Hallelujah. Are you with me? So that is a spiritual song. Now a spiritual song can be a psalm or a hymn. But it comes straight, boom, from the spirit realm. Boom. Like that. And you access it. Hallelujah. You access it. So sometimes the sound is playing, the song is playing, and you access the song. But like what I did it raw. I accessed the sound, I accessed the sound of the drums, then I accessed the sound of the keyboard, then I accessed the words, and I put it together. And we got ourselves a what? A song from the spirit realm. That's what it means. A song from the spirit realm. I say stop, stop, no further. Hey! I say stop, stop, no further.
Satan, you have come too far enough.
I say stop, stop, no further. Somebody put your hand up.
I say stop, stop, no further.
Jesus.
I say stop, stop, no further. Satan, you have come far enough.
I say stop, stop, no further. Now let me tell you something. When the song came, before the song came, I had a vision. I had a vision of a traffic cop with white things standing and saying, stop. That's what I saw. I had a vision of a traffic cop saying, stop, stop. And as I saw the vision, stop, the words came in my spirit. And I heard, I say stop, stop, no further. Come on.
I say stop, stop, no further.
Let you want your house.
Devil, you have come
far enough.
I say stop, stop, no further.
I say stop,
stop, stop.
Look at
no
your
further.
Finances, your home, everything
stop,
around you.
Stop, no further.
Hey. Devil, you have come
far enough.
I say stop, stop, no further.
One more time.
I say stop,
stop, no further. I say stop, stop, no further. Devil, you have come far enough.
This is dangerous.
I say stop, stop, no further.
I'm guessing the verse. Satan's been roaming up and down the earth, looking for someone to devour. I am not your candidate, no, not ever. I say stop, stop, no further. Come on.
Satan has been roaming up and down the earth, looking for a candidate to stop.
No, Now here's the thing. When I get it the first time, I may not even remember it the second time. I'm teaching you. Okay? So I have to go back in. Okay. Hallelujah. Continue the beat. Hallelujah. Satan has been roaming up and down the earth looking for someone to devour. I will be your candidate. So stop, stop, stop. Come on.
Satan has been roaming up and down the earth looking for someone to devour.
So I would.
So I am not your candidate. So stop, stop, no further.
Come on.
Satan has been roaming up and down the earth looking for someone to devour. I am not your candidate.
I say stop,
stop, no further.
The verse.
Stop, stop, no further. I say stop, stop, no further.
Now the verse.
Devil, you have not
far enough.
I say stop, stop, no further.
Now, you can see, this team that works with me, you need to pray for them for memory. When you're praying for the praise and worship team, say, Heavenly Father, give Elder Dion sharp memory. When Bishop starts singing, that she remembers it instantly. Give Pastor Rita sharp memory that she remembers instantly. Give the whole backup team sharp memory so that they will remember instantly. Woo! That's it. So I just did a demonstration for you. Hallelujah. So the Bible says that we are supposed to be filled. Now here's the thing about this. Do you know if you start singing like this, you're going to get drunk? You're going to get intoxicated with it. It says, do not be filled with wine. Do not be drunk on wine, but be filled with the Spirit. That means filling with the Spirit can get you drunk. And then it says, speaking to yourselves. Woo! In psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. So you're going through your day, you say, I say, stop, stop, no further. Okay, while you're doing your washing, you are washing the dishes. You say, I say, stop,
stop, no further.
Hey!
I say, stop, stop, no further. The devil, you have come far enough. I say, stop, stop, no further.
So that's it. So you go all around, all your day, you sing it. I say stop,
stop, no further.
Unless you sing it, you're going to get full of that revelation. Amen. And then if the Satan dares to attack you, hey, the level of ferocity that will come out of you, the devil will have to go for rehab. Amen. Are you hearing me? I've come to prophesy to somebody that the anointing in that song is going to call somebody to rise up with fire, rise up with anointing, rise up with power, and drive the devil back, because you will not be devoured. You are not a candidate. That's what the word of the Lord is saying. That means there are people under the sound of my voice. You are being devoured. But I've come to announce today that the anointing rises in your life. That anointing comes into your house. And you say, stop, stop, no further. I'm ready to preach. Hallelujah. Let's go into the Word of God. Hallelujah. Let's go into the Word. Hallelujah. I follow the Holy Ghost, so you cannot predict the bishop. You don't know what I'm going to do because I don't know myself. I just come and I just yield to the flow of the Holy Ghost. I'm a prophet. I'm not a pastor, so I'm not predictable. I go with the flow. There is a prophetic flow. The Bible talks about speaking by sudden inspiration of the moment. So there is a sudden inspiration. I was singing one moment, then the preach fell upon me. Then all of a sudden I switched. Hallelujah. Because the anointing just switched. Because I minister by sudden inspiration of the moment. Hallelujah. I'm going to continue the series because today is the prophetic day of spiritual alignment, and somebody needs to get aligned. Somebody needs to understand what spiritual alignment is. For there's an alignment that must come into your life. Now the Bible says that one of the disciples came to Jesus and said, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus said, in this manner pray. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. He said, thy kingdom come. That means the government of heaven, the government of heaven be superimposed upon the earth. He said, let the kingdom come. Now we know that in the earth, the Bible says the whole earth lieth in darkness. So he said, let the kingdom of God come. Let the kingdom of God come. Let the agenda of God come. So spiritual alignment is bringing the agenda of God to the earth, and you aligning with it. And then he says, pray this, thy will be done on earth as it's done in heaven. So there is an alignment that must happen in your life. That means your circumstances must come into alignment. But here's the thing, many times we pray for our circumstances to come into alignment, but we are not in alignment. I said, we are what? Not in alignment. So we need to be in alignment for the circumstances to come into alignment. So I have come to let somebody know that spiritual alignment is bringing yourself into alignment with the plans and purposes of God for your life. It's you coming into alignment, so what is written about you in the books of destiny will come to pass in your life. Now let's talk also about, if you don't understand spiritual things, the first thing you got to do is to understand its equivalent in the natural. So there's an equivalent in the natural that you've got to understand. And if you understand the equivalent in the natural, then it's easier to understand it in the spirit. So that's why when Jesus was preaching and teaching, he would use a lot of natural examples to understand, explain spiritual things, so that people would understand what he's saying. So let me use an example. So have you ever received an email, or you received a photo, or you received something on your phone, but then when you went to open it, it said file type not recognized? That's what it's saying. It's saying that what you received, your phone is not aligned to it. That means, so you received it. It came into your phone. It came into your phone, but your phone could not open it because your phone was not aligned to the file. And so sometimes you need to go and search and find, say example, you could receive a PDF document, but your phone does not have a PDF reader. So you need to go and download a PDF reader so your phone would be what? Aligned to the document you have received. Well, I've come to tell you that just as it is in the natural, so it is in the spirit. The Heavenly Father could have sent you a divine intervention. The Heavenly Father could have sent you an answer. The Heavenly Father could have sent you a promotion. The Heavenly Father could have sent you your destiny. The moment of your destiny could have come. But guess what? You are not aligned with it. It is actually on your fire. It is on, it is in your space. It is in your spiritual space. It's within your spiritual circumference. It's within your reach. But because in your spiritual hard drive, in your mind drive, and in your spirit drive, and in your emotional drive, you don't have the fire. You don't have the thinking. You don't have the program to open what God has sent to you. Then what God sent to you stays there. Oh, so there are people who God has sent things to you, but guess what? You do not have the program to open it. That means you are not aligned to what God has sent to you. So there is an alignment problem. Mm-mm-mm. Oh, hallelujah. Have you ever heard somebody who you sent, you actually sent a file to them, they receive the file, and they say there's a problem with your phone? There's no problem with your phone. Your phone doesn't have a problem. You just don't have the file. And then sometimes, if you go and try to download the file, sometimes you say, no memory. That means your phone doesn't have the memory. That means your phone's capacity cannot receive the program to open the file. But the file is on your phone. But your capacity needs to increase. That's why in Isaiah 54, when the prophet was prophesying to Israel, he says what? Enlarge your tent. He says stretch forth the stakes. He says enlarge. That means your capacity needs to increase. Your spiritual capacity needs to increase. Your mental capacity needs to increase. Your emotional capacity needs to increase. There needs to be some horizontal growth so there can be some vertical growth. I've come to prophesy to somebody that the things that you've prayed for are already in your space, but you think they are not there because you cannot open the miracle. You cannot open the provision. You cannot open the destiny. You cannot open the next level because on you is an old program. But I've come to prophesy to somebody that in the month of June, the Spirit of God would work on you, and you will yield to God, you will bow to God, so that you receive the right program to open the things that God has for you. You see, there's always man's responsibility. It's the person's responsibility to send you the file, but it's your responsibility to download the application, to download the program that will open the file. That's why the Bible says you renew your mind. It says you present your body a living sacrifice unto God, which is your reasonable service. The Lord can do that for you. There's some files that you cannot open until you crucify your flesh. There's some files that you cannot open until you renew your mind. But I came to prophesy to somebody who has files of destiny on their life. Files of destiny have been downloaded into your space. Files of destiny have been downloaded into your life, but they have not been opened. But now I've come to prophesy that in the name of Jesus, them files will not stay there forever. I've come to prophesy that this month the grace of God shall work in your life, and you shall be transformed. Oh, let us go into the word. I'm going to continue speaking on the doings of God require the stretchings of man. The doings of God. I recently received a file. It was a file. It was a file that I've never received in my phone. It was a geological file. It was a geological file that was full of coordinates to do with a particular project that I'm working on. And my phone does not have that type of app because I've never entered into that space of work. So it was sent to me via WhatsApp. But even though it was sent to me via WhatsApp, I could not open it. So I had to go and look for a new kind of file that I did not know existed. If I tell you the file, most of you listening to me would already know those files existed, because I will send a KMZ file. Now, who knows anything about KMZ? You don't know anything about KMZ because you don't work in the space of KMZ. But KMZ, the space of KMZ is a space I am called to. So what happened? I received some information on my phone that can only be downloaded with a KMZ program. So I had to go to my Google Play Store and find myself a KMZ app to do what? Open the file, because hallelujah, if I did not do that, the file would not be open and the information that I needed to have and process would not be there. So I've come to tell you that there are things that heaven has already given you, but you have not accessed them because you think it's all about God sending what God can send, but you need to align so you can receive. So God sent. So as far as God is concerned, he has answered your prayer. Your prayer is answered. If you check the database of heaven, on this day he sent the answer. On this day it landed in your life, but you have not opened it because you don't have the program tool. But when this series is over, you will understand that the doings of God require the stretchings of man. So there shall be a stretching. So I had to stretch my phone, because my phone had never had those types of files, and me, I'm an extremist. So in what I do, I put 3 KMZ programs. I checked them all. Some said 4.7 ratings, 4.8 and 4.9. So I said, just in case one doesn't work properly, I download all 3. Oh, glory. So right now, my phone has been KMZ optimized. My phone has been KMZ stretched. I'm ready for anything in the dimension of KMZ. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody say, the doings of God require my stretchings. The doings of God require my stretchings. Let's go into the word. Exodus chapter 20 verse 1. Exodus chapter 20 verse 1. Because there is an alignment that must happen right now. And God spoke all these words saying, I am the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that's in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them. For I am the Lord your God. I'm a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing mercy for thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. And as the scroll of heaven was revealed to me, there are some Holy Spirit wisdom points, Holy Spirit wisdom secrets that were given to me. The first one is that worship is the gateway of spiritual alignment. So you cannot align spiritually without aligning to your source. So spiritual alignment to the divine is impossible without worship. So if you want to begin to spiritually align, you first of all need to align. You need to align in the area of worship. If I want to add a KMZ program to my phone, the first thing I've got to do is check whether I have some memory. There is a particular tablet that I got for my wife. I thought the tablet would work really well, but me not being very literate in some things, the tablet did not really have the memory to do the things that she wanted. So what I had to do, I had to expand the tablet by getting an SD card. And so I got an SD card to put in the tablet to expand the tablet. You see, there are things that the Lord God wants to do in your life. But the first thing you got to do is you got to make sure that you are aligned with Him. You are aligned with Him. Now, making sure that your phone has enough memory is not the only thing that needs to happen for you to be able to receive new files in a new format that you have never received before. So the first thing you've got to do when it comes to receiving divine things from heaven is that you have first of all got to get into a worship alignment, because worship is the gateway of spiritual alignment. That's why the Bible says enter His gates with thanksgiving and to His courts with praise, because worship is the door to the spirit realm. Through worship you ascend to the spirit realm. You can either ascend into the realms of heaven or ascend into the realms of darkness. But I've come to prophesy to somebody that your worship needs to be restored. Your worship needs to rise to the levels that it should be. You need to bow to the divine. The second thing is this, is that worship is the bowing of man's will to the divine. So worship is the bowing of man's will to the divine. The reason why the angels bow is they're bowing, it's the physical representation of the bowing. Now, I have preached that before about 2 or 3 weeks ago, but I need to preach it again, because repetition is the mother of learning. And it has been proven that when you hear something, if you don't go back to it within 8 days, you actually lose over 60% of it. So you need to go back. That's why repetition is very important. So anyone who wants to establish people in the things of the Spirit needs to know how to repeat things until you know where I'm going even before I start. That means it's got into your system. So worship is a gateway of spiritual alignment, and worship is the bowing of your will to the divine. Now, any mother who is a good cook, now there's some ministers, they're not good cooks, because a minister is a chef. The head chef in the church is the pastor. Like example, I am the head chef of this ministry. That means I prepare, I'm the main preparer of the food. My wife is a sanctification and she's also a wisdom chef, and I have a number of other chefs all working in this restaurant called Divine Visitation Assemblies. Now, do you know something? If you don't like the restaurant, and guess what, you're not the head chef, leave the restaurant. Because the head chef is the one that's going to provide the food. And if the food makes you toxic, the food makes you throw up, then guess what? Don't curse the restaurant. Leave the restaurant. There are the restaurants that God has raised up. So there's some of you, you are smiling because God has sent you to this restaurant, this divine restaurant that has some real good heavenly food. So the minister of God, the shepherd of God, he is a chef. Are you hearing what I'm saying? He is a chef. Now, a good chef does not just, if you have a mother who's a good chef, that mother will not be, the child will not say, "Mother, why do you give us bakes every day? Bakes, 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 bakes." No. A good mother will understand, I'm going to use the flour on Monday to make some bakes. Then I will use the same flour on Tuesday to make some pancakes. Then I will use the same flour on Wednesday to make some banana fritters. Then I will use the same flour on Thursday to make some pumpkin fritters. Then I will use the same flour on Friday to make some fish cakes. Hallelujah. Because guess what? They are a chef, but they are still giving you what? The same flour. So today, I am giving you some flour that I've given you before. But guess what? I mixed it and I added some flavor to it. So it tastes different. So you think it's different, but it's the same thing, because I'm giving you in a different way. Because guess what? I'm a master chef. Oh, hallelujah. Woo! Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo-hoo. So Some of you didn't know I understand cooking. I just can't cook. So, Jeremiah chapter 19:5. If there was a competition to describe the art of cooking, I would beat some of you who can cook. But guess what? It's all what? Talk. That's why the Bible says the kingdom of God is not in word but in power. Oh Lord, ain't got no power in the kitchen, but let me tell you, I've got talk. Okay, let's go back to the subject. Worship is the bowing down of man's will to the divine. Worship is what? The bowing down of man's will to the divine. Let's turn to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 19, verse 12. You know, these scriptures came to me supernaturally. Yesterday, I was in the presence of the Lord. I saw in my spirit written, Exodus 20, verse 5. And then I saw written in my spirit, Jeremiah 19, verse 5. So those scriptures were given to me in the prophetic, and they linked together for me to preach to you. Oh, hallelujah. He says, Jeremiah 19 verse 5. He says, they have also built the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings to Baal, which I did not command or speak, nor did it come to my mind. So the Lord is saying, he says, the children of Israel, they offered their sons to Baal in worship. You see, the Spirit of God then spoke to me. He said, whenever you worship, there's a sacrifice. He says, whenever you worship the demonic, there is a sacrifice. And then he began to speak to me. He said, when you worshiped that spirit at that time of your life, this is what you sacrificed. So there's some people, you worship the spirit of anger and you sacrifice your job. There's some people you worshipped the spirit of gossip and you sacrificed a divine friendship. There's some people you worship the spirit of unforgiveness and you lost a divine connection. Because the Bible says that when you worship, you must do what? Sacrifice. And when you worship, you receive a reward. And when you worship God, you receive life. But when you worship the forces of darkness, you receive death. So whenever you worship any of the array of spirits, you see, some people think worship is you standing before a statue and bowing down. No, there are people who you worship your negative emotions. So there are people under the sound of my voice, you don't worship God, you worship your feelings. And when you worship your feelings, you alienate yourself from divine relationships and you lose your destiny. And you sacrifice joy, peace, love, and you sacrifice where you are born into the earth, all because you worship your feelings. But I'm here to raise up a people who will not worship their feelings. They will not worship devils. Now, when you worship your feelings, is it really your feelings you're worshiping? No, you're worshiping an emotional devil. I said you're worshiping an emotional mood swinging devil. Your mind, your mood swings like a pendulum. The pendulum that rings like this, your mood swings further than that. I mean, in 1 minute it swings from east to west, north to south. I mean, some pendulums swing this way, your swing this way and swing that way. I mean, I'll tell you, that means there's a devil there. You say, but my feelings are real. Guess what? Devils are real too. You've got to understand you're worshiping a devil. I said, you're not worshiping God. You're worshiping a devil. I said, you're worshiping a devil. That I'm not here to give you some psychological babble. I'm not here to give you some psychotherapy babble. I'm not telling you to cope with a devil. I'm telling you to cut and clip and cut yourself from that devil. I'm telling you to rise up and say, stop no further. There are people under the sound of my voice, spiritual, emotional devils run up and down your life. And because you worship them, you have lost so much. How can you be creative when you're moody? Oh my God. How can you create when you're moody? How can you excel when you're moody? Is your name El Moody? Oh, Lord. Oh, bless the Lord. I tell you, somebody needs, I'm seeing in the spirit. You know, some people, you know their Spanish names. You know, some people are called Susie. No, we should now call you Susie El Moody. Now, we're not only talking about women who are moody. Do you know which is worse? A man who's moody or a woman who's moody? A man. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Lord. A moody man is far dangerous than a moody woman. Are you with me? Because when a man gets moody, his testosterone gets moody. When his testosterone gets moody, his strength gets moody. And all of a sudden, his force gets moody. And he starts being forceful in the negative. Hey, hear you, brother. Brother, it's time to stop worshiping that moody devil. Is your name Brother El Moody? I am not Mr. El Moody or Bishop El Moody, and I do not have El Moody sons or El Moody daughters. We are people of joy. We are people of peace. We worship God, the God of the heavens and the earth. Some people say, leave me in my mood. Okay, so we'll leave you with your devil, Madam El Moody and Mr. El Moody. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. Ramanda Shete Boris. Somebody say, El Moody, stop. No more, no more, no more. Don't worship emotional devils. Don't worship alienation devils. Don't worship those kinds of spirits. They will destroy your life, destroy your destiny. Jesus. Whew. Now, worship glass ceilings are broken when people break the alabaster box of their selfishness and pride. Jesus. You see, there is a worship that will never occur until you break your alabaster box. Let's turn to the scriptures. Let's turn to the book of Matthew chapter 26 verse 6. Matthew chapter 26 verse 6. You cannot worship self and worship God. You cannot half worship. You see, worship is something you cannot do half. Worship is something that you cannot do quarter. Worship is something you cannot do two-thirds. You're either worshiping or you're not. You're either in or you're out. You know, it's like some people say, well, nothing really happened. Did something happen? Yes, but nothing really happened. Wait, is either something happened or something didn't happen? Well, there's no well. Jesus. You either worshipped or you didn't worship. Something happened or something didn't happen. Karaba Sandai. Oh Lord. So we're saying, Bishop, don't go there. Don't go there. Don't go there. Go there. Don't. We pray that the prophetic be blinded. We pray that the prophetic be blinded. We pray right now for mercy and grace. Isaraba. Matthew chapter 26, verse 6. And when Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil. And she poured it on his head as she sat at the table. And when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, why the waste? For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor. You see, worship is expensive. You see, worship is expensive. And your worship to the Lord is trapped in an alabaster box called you. You are a vessel, and your worship is trapped in that box. And you are the carrier of that worship. Now, you have to worship, because you cannot exist on the earth without worshiping. You must worship. People who commit suicide worship disappointment. People who commit suicide are actually worshiping death. The worship of death is what causes people to commit suicide. But you are worshiping something. You are worshiping a spirit. So everybody is a worshiping creature. Man is a worshiping creature by nature. So right now you are worshiping. I just don't know what. I just don't know what you're worshiping. So if you are going to come into spiritual alignment, your worship must come. Your worship life must come first into alignment. And for your worship life to come into alignment, you need to understand that many times in worship, people reach glass ceilings. What are glass ceilings? A glass ceiling is a ceiling that you see that's there. You can see what's beyond the ceiling, but you can't get there because the ceiling is there. So many times people come to church and they see other people worship. They see other people get encounters. They see the presence of God come on people. They see worship. They see the alignment of worship transforms people's lives. And yet they seek to get to that place, but they cannot, because there is a glass ceiling. Where the glass ceiling is found in this story of the alabaster box. You see, for the fragrant oil to be released, because the Bible talks about first it was fragrance, then it turned to fire. So you see, worship is a fragrance. The Bible said that he smelt the sweet fragrance of their sacrifice. He said he smelt the sweet fragrance of their worship. So you see, worship is a fragrance. Let's go. First it was what? Fragrance. Then it turned to fire. My worship is my weapon. This is how I win my battle. Woo! First it was fragrance, then it turned to fire. My worship is my weapon. This is how I win my battle. That's right. So worship is a fragrance. So the fragrance of worship was in that alabaster box. So there's you are like an alabaster box. On the inside of you is the fragrance of your worship that would touch heaven, that would move heaven, and it would be converted from fragrance to fire upon the earth. But this is the thing, that worship will stay in that bottle until your alabaster box breaks. And the problem is, many people do not have a broken spirit. So when the Bible talks about a broken spirit, it talks about, you see, the Bible says the Lord draws near to he that is of a broken and contrite heart. He says the Lord is near to those who have a broken and a contrite heart. What is he talking about? He's talking about somebody who has broken their alabaster box. You see, on the inside of you, there's worship. On the inside of you, there's anointing. But around you is your human vessel called your flesh. So you need to break your flesh. Don't say, Lord, break my flesh. He's not going to. You have to break your flesh. You have to do what? Break your flesh. Oh, you got to break your flesh. You got to break your flesh. So there are people under the sound of my voice who struggle with worship because there are two things you got to break. Number one, for you to worship, you got to break your self-image. Because there is no way to worship. Worship is your spirit intersecting with God. And when your spirit intersects with God, sometimes you cry, sometimes you fall, sometimes you weep, sometimes you laugh, sometimes you spin, sometimes you run, sometimes you bow. But when your spirit, for that to happen, your flesh has got to break. And for your flesh to break, the first thing that needs to do is the selfishness of your flesh. So a lot of people don't worship because they're looking around. They're thinking of what people will say. They are thinking of themselves. So they are too caught up with themselves, because when you worship, you forget about yourself. Because when you worship, you cannot worship with yourself on your mind. You can never worship. So people who are self-dominated, who themselves is the center of their universe, always have worship problems because they cannot worship. Because guess what? You are not the center of the universe. You are around a universe of God. And you have a part to play. So you need to understand this. The universe doesn't revolve around you. Neither do people's lives revolve around you. People's lives do not revolve around me. I do not think that. This is what I think. How the word says is that I am part of a puzzle. That's all. I'm part of a puzzle. I'm simply a part of a puzzle. And there are some puzzle pieces that are around me. And I relate with the pieces that are around me. And you must relate with the pieces that are around you. Because that's how it works. But the world does not revolve around me. The world is bigger than anybody. I said the world is bigger than anybody. The world is bigger than anybody. That is why when a hurricane is coming, it doesn't notify you and ask your permission. That's why when coronavirus was coming, it didn't say, do you have a wedding planned? The folks who are planning Kadument, it didn't say, Kadument is coming, we'll come after Kadument. I mean, are you with me? It said, you have what? So it actually did not discuss with them. There was no discussion. It just came. Because guess what? The universe does not revolve around anybody. You are just part of a big thing. And you need to understand what is your part. So when you worship, you need to understand that. So people who have a fixation with themselves. It's like there was a lady. She was in a meeting. She had HIV. I did not know she had HIV. But she had another condition. And she came to my healing service. And when she came to my healing service, I called out a condition that she heard. And the Lord healed her. And when the Lord healed her, I then called another condition, which was a blood condition. And she actually did not come. Because she thought that people would say she came twice. Now, that is a woman who worships what other people say. If I have HIV and I came to a service and I had a condition and the condition got healed instantly and the same man calls me for my blood condition, I will not go because I'm thinking of what other people say. Jesus. And when she came to me after, the anointing for HIV had gone. Because the gift of healing to heal blood conditions had already left. But the woman does not worship God. She worships herself. She looks at life through how people look at herself. She is image. She worships her image. And let me tell you, nobody in that service was studying her. Nobody in that service was studying what she said. Wait, do you think you are so important that we have you on our mind? When we come to church, we're studying whether you sing or dance. You are not that important. The other thing is pride. Pride is an enemy of worship. Because in pride, you exalt yourself beyond what you are. So the people who exalt themselves. So the people who are selfish or they're prideful. And when you're prideful and you believe you're bigger than you are, you will never worship. Because you think you're bigger than God, smarter than God, you're better than everybody else, you're better than the singer, better than the band, better than this. Why are they doing this? Why this is wrong? Listen, if you are so good, why is your life a mess? Why are you broke? Why are things in your life a mess? Miss Perfect, Mr. Perfect, why is your life? I know you can put on a perfect outfit, but it's just an outfit. It's just an outfit. Your life is a mess. So your life is a mess. Yet you come and you're expecting anything that is, why did they do this? Why did they do this? Why did they do this? When your own life, why don't you practice that on yourself? Perhaps you will improve. So perhaps you improve. So what happens to people is that you need to break the alabaster box of pride and selfishness. And when you do that, the fragrance of the worship that's in you will come out. Somebody's worship is going to come out today. I said somebody's worship. I came to declare to somebody that there's a way you've worshipped, that you're now going to worship God for real. For Jesus said that the Father is seeking for those that would worship him in spirit and in truth. And you are about to step into that dimension of worshiping God in spirit and in truth. Oh, hallelujah. The word also tells us in the next statement that the Holy Spirit gave me is that I saw on the scroll. Now, when I say scroll, is that I get my prophetic messages in a scroll. So I see them. And on the scroll was written, students of worship do not worship. For worship is not something you study, it's something you do. So the people who, they study what everybody's doing in service. They study, they say, minister, you're on fire today. Hey, the way the anointing worked today, woo. How come you had so much information? Hey, so what were you doing? When I was leading worship, you were studying how I was leading? So those who study worship do not worship. So the people, when worship is going, they're studying. Woo, the anointing is moving in the church today. Hey, sister, this thing is getting a breakthrough. Sister Roseanne, she's crying. Brother Jimmy, he's not getting in like he got last Friday. I wonder what the problem is. Brother Francis, his face is sour. Oh, my God. I wonder what is going on. And look at Princess. Princess is getting bad. She's getting bad. She's getting bad. Oh my God, she's getting in deep. And here you are the worship correspondent. You are detailing everybody how they're worshiping, but you are not worshiping. Let me explain to you. There is no ministry in the body of Christ called the student of worship, or the studier of worship, or the worship observer, or the worship reporter. So take your report of worship and zip your mouth. We don't want to hear worship. Where were you that you have so much information? We were all experiencing the presence of the Lord. We were all experiencing the glory of the Lord. We were all experiencing the power of God. We were all in the secret place of the Most High. And all you were doing is observing. Jesus. Woo! There is no position called worship observer or worship police. Jesus. My. Next thing I've got to share with you is this. Is that worship produces an alignment that opens up the world of alignment with your destiny. So worship produces an alignment. So there's an alignment that comes with worship. So when you worship, so the first thing in your relationship with God is your worship life. The first thing in relating with the Father is your worship life. It's more important than your destiny. So the first thing is your worship. And when you worship God, you come into alignment with Him. And when you come into alignment with Him, something happens. Because the Bible says, God is not mocked. And whatsoever man soweth, that shall he reap. He that soweth to the Spirit. And so the angel of the Lord showed me that worship is the greatest seed that man can sow. And when you sow worship, the Bible says, he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And what is everlasting life? Everlasting life is not that you shall live forever, because everybody shall live forever. What Jesus gave you was an everlasting destiny. Jesus gave you an everlasting mission. So when you got born again, you began a life that will continue forever. So everlasting life is an everlasting destiny. It's everlasting progress. It's everlasting moving from glory to glory, from realm to realm. So when you received Jesus, you stepped into a realm of everlasting promotion, everlasting progress, everlasting heights, everlasting move from dimension to dimension. So come to prophesy to somebody that if you want to know what your destiny is, worship. And when you sow the seed of worship, you would reap a harvest called a revelation of what your destiny. People who worship get pregnant with destiny. For there's a realm that must be entered. There's a realm that must be entered today. For there's an alignment that must come to my people, said the Lord. And there are many people who are sitting on the outskirts of worship. You're crying unto me to show me where you were born. But I cannot. I cannot, because I already have. And you must go into the realm to receive the information. And the realm to receive the information of your destiny is the realm of worship. If you will come and worship me, if you bow your will to my will, if you will exalt my will above your will, if you will exalt my ways above your ways, if you will humbly bow and break your flesh and break your pride and break your selfishness and break the alabaster box of your selfishness and break the alabaster box of your pride, if you will do that and cause the fragrance of your worship to ascend before me, you will ascend into a realm where the fragrance of God will come upon your life. You see, because not only will your worship be fragrant, but your life will become fragrant, because there is a fragrant life. There's a life that has the smell of heaven. There's a life that has the fragrance of favor. There's a life that has the fragrance of peace. There's a life that has the fragrance of prosperity that the Lord has for you. But you must first give him the fragrance of your worship. And when you give him the fragrance of your worship, you shall now step into the realm where you have the fragrant destiny. For the Bible says that in Christ, he causes us to triumph in every place, and the savor of the anointing flows from us. So in your life, your destiny will carry the savor, the fragrance of the anointing and the power and the glory of God. So there is a fragrant life that awaits you, but you must sow the seed of worship. The seed of worship. So you must sow the seed of worship. So worship produces an alignment that opens up the world of alignment with your destiny. Okay, the sixth point that I saw on the scroll is that divine destiny is the mission you're sent on the earth to execute, with all its opportunities, battles, resources, and graces. So divine destiny is the mission on earth you are sent to. Elohim is a mission God. Everything he does has a mission. The flies have a mission. The cloud has a mission. The air has a mission. Oxygen has a mission. Water has a mission. Everything he creates has a mission. And you also have a mission. You also have a mission. So your divine destiny is the mission you are called on earth to execute. You are sent to the earth to execute. And it comes with all the graces, all the opportunities, all the battles. And so when you come into worship alignment, destiny is revealed to you, and you can then come into what? Destiny alignment. I said destiny alignment. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. He said, in this day and in this hour, the word that you must speak to my church, as a prophet of the wise virgin church, you must speak to them and declare, it is the time for spiritual alignment. It is a time for men to align with God in worship, and to align with the coordinates of their destiny. To align with the coordinates of your destiny. My destiny has coordinates. What do you mean, the coordinates of my destiny? I know everything God has called me to do, and all those things he's called me to do create a boundary around me. That's the country that I live in. So I live in the country of the prophetic, prophesying and releasing the power of God to deliver people. So let me explain it this way. One aspect of my calling is what? To my entire mission, my entire life is to represent the move of God, is to represent a greatness move of God. Okay, is to represent a greatness move of God. I take a people from bondage to greatness. Okay, that's but my personal calling is to represent a greatness move of God. The calling in our ministry is to take a people from bondage to greatness. Hallelujah. Take a people from bondage to greatness. Okay, that's what I give my life for. That's the call of God, that heaven. That's our heavenly commission. But when it now comes to the boundaries of that calling, on the right, we say, in the north, is the boundary of, hallelujah, take your prophets and miracle ministry and rescue greatness from the fires of hell and preserve it from decadence and in this time well pleased. That's my prophetic and deliverance ministry, which I was doing on Friday night. Oh Lord, I had a blast on Friday night. Hallelujah. I could have gone until 6 o'clock in the morning. Java. Now I was tired when I woke up, but when I was under that anointing, I was born for that. Amen. I was born for that. And we now have to do Tuesday because Monday is fully booked. We now have the next week. And the week is filling up. Bless the Lord. So the week is filling up. I think the Thursday. Is it Thursday? Yeah, Thursday is. The Thursday is filling up. My staff were looking at me like, Tuesday? Wow, Tuesday. No. It's filling up. So on one boundary of my life is what? Prophetic deliverance. Rescuing the greatness of people from the fires of hell. On another side is taking wisdom to visionaries. On another side is prophesying and preaching and raising up the wise virgin church. On another side is bringing economic dignity to the Caribbean through business and through relationship with Israel. And that is the boundaries of my life. Those are my spiritual coordinates. I function in those coordinates. I don't step out. Those are the coordinates of my destiny. So your destiny has coordinates. Jesus. Oh my God. Your destiny has coordinates. Your destiny has a boundary. Your destiny has a realm that you stay in. So you need to know the coordinates. And each gift that you have with the calling on it defines the coordinates. So I know my north, my south, my east, and my west. And I stay inside it and go from realm to realm to realm. I just released a wisdom bomb to somebody that they need to understand the coordinates of their destiny. It's a secret in which people don't understand that is the zip code of your favor. You see, because I understood that in that place is the zip code of my progress. Let me tell you, when I landed in that zip code, I understood something. That promotion doesn't come from the west. Promotion doesn't come from the south. Promotion doesn't come from the east. But it comes from the north. It comes from heaven. And when I stepped into the coordinates of that destiny, all of a sudden, I started going from promotion to promotion. Every year, I get multiple promotions. I just received one. But I'll tell you later. You say, how is Bishop getting so much promotion? Because I have found the spiritual coordinates of my destiny, and the spirit of counsel shall come on somebody, it shall rest on somebody, so that the coordinates of your destiny, you see, Satan wants to take you outside of the coordinates of that destiny, because within the coordinates there are angelic warriors. The Bible says the Lord encamps around them that fear the Lord. Well, the encampment of angels is around the coordinates of my destiny. It's around the coordinates of your destiny. But if you don't know the destiny, you will not come into alignment with it. That's why God spoke to Abraham. He says, I want you to get out of Ur of the Chaldees to a land that I will show you, because in that land are the coordinates of your destiny. In that place I will make of you a great nation. In that place I will make your name great. In that place I will bless you and be a blessing. Well, that location for Abraham under the Old Testament was a physical location, but for us in the New Testament, it's a spiritual location. It's a location on the earth. It's a location of endeavor. It's a location of work. The Bible tells us that God spoke to Moses. He said, I'm going to bring the people out, and I'm going to bring them into a land of milk and honey. This is the promised land. But I've come to tell you, your promised land is the land of your destiny. It's the land of your gifting. It's the land of your calling. I know the giants protecting it. I know the strong men protecting it. But I've come to tell you, there's an anointing that's going to rise upon you. You're going to be a giant killer. And the river Jordan shall part hither and thither. Every wall of Jericho shall come down. You shall step into the coordinates of your destiny. When you step into that coordinates, you become what? A superman. Because those are the coordinates of your destiny. Everything is not for me, but I know the coordinates of my calling. Hey. The These are called spiritual destiny coordinates. Mm-mm-mm. Spiritual destiny coordinates. Mm-mm-mm. Oh, let's move to the next one. I preached on it. I said that when we worship, it's a seed. And that seed is released. We set something in motion in the spirit realm. You see, people need to understand that worship, true worship, is a seed that will always produce a harvest. So, people do not understand how to activate the divine. I know how to activate the divine. I know how to activate the divine. Right now, I can stand here and I activate power. If I activate power, this whole streaming is over. Because everybody who is there will be on the floor. Everybody here will be in the spirit. Everybody back there will go. Because there are just some buttons in the spirit I know how to press. Now, that's because I understand how to sow, how to set in motion spiritual things. Woo! Hallelujah! La brosa namando shake. Yeah. But I just saw something in the spirit. Jesus. Let me don't do that. Because it will mess up the stage. Ratakata kasakata. Hey! Landaraba sotoroya. Oh, glory be to God. As I said that, I began to see things in the spirit realm. But I'm going to pull myself back and get back to preaching. Oh, Lord. Mm-hmm. Okay. Number 7. The next thing you need to get aligned with is alignment with relationships. So there's an alignment with worship, there's an alignment with your mission, and there's an alignment with what? Your relationships. Now, I saw this in the scroll of heaven, in the scroll that was given to me. Relationships in the spirit are pieces of your puzzle that align, that allow the picture of your destiny to be formed on earth. You need to be writing this down. These points that I'm giving you, these wisdom seekers I'm giving you, I did not give them of myself. They come to me in a scroll. Jesus. Mandada. They come to me and I preach from that scroll. Jesus. Mamba batabadasha. Relationships in the spirit are the pieces of your puzzle that allow the picture of your destiny to be formed on the earth. So, God, you could see after worship your destiny. And you could see the coordinates of your destiny. But whenever God calls you, God always gives you two things. God always gives you people to work with. Now, if you don't know your with, you will never experience your destiny. When Jesus was called, as he began his calling, the first thing he did was to find his with. Because his calling was supposed to be done with Peter, James, John, Judas, Thomas, Philip, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Susanna, Lazarus. Those are all part of his with. Now, there are people that you are supposed to, your destiny is done with. So destiny is always done with. So there are people who do not, the people who do not understand this. You see, when the Bible says love your neighbor, it's speaking about loving your destiny neighbor. That's love the people that you do destiny with. Now, you do not choose who you do destiny with. You discover who you do destiny with. And I'm sure the disciples being the disciples, that some of them didn't like each other. In fact, they had some big arguments. In fact, the Bible says that Jesus had to calm them down after, I myself would have got vexed. Because when the mother of James and John, it's like, say example, there is a vacancy for a pastor position in another country. And instead of one of my leaders who is working in church come to me, their mother, who is not part of the ministry comes and books an appointment with me to talk to me about giving her son or daughter that position. Hey, the Bible says that when the rest of the disciples heard it, they were incensed. The scripture says they were what? Incensed. That day, James and John did not win a popularity contest. I mean, I can imagine Peter. Can you imagine Peter? Peter rebuked Jesus. So if he rebuked the master, And we know that he had a pocket of unsanctification which had some F words. Because when they said you are with Jesus, the Bible says he released some curse bombs. So we know he had it in him. So you can imagine what happened on that day. So, but these people were supposed to be together. And there is also, we can also see that there was some level of tension in the early days between Peter and John. Because the Bible tells us that Peter, after Jesus told him, because remember, John was very intimate with Jesus. And when John was the only disciple that was with him at the cross. And John was the one who laid his head on his breast. Okay? So John was very close with Jesus. So the people knew John. Because here's the thing. There are people who say, everybody must have the same access, the same relationship with the bishop. Read your Bible. Read your Bible. When Jesus took a team to Jairus' house, who did he take? Peter, James, and John. He left Thomas and Andrew out because that was not their place. When he went up to the Mount of Transfiguration, he took what? Peter, James, and John. When he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, he takes Peter, James, and John. And the some of you are like,
why does the bishop always take this, that, and that?
Do you know the altitude and the pressure that comes with what they're doing? You see, not every plane is built for every altitude. Jesus. I said, not every plane is built for every altitude. So you need to understand that God knows what you're built for. God knows what you're built for. To be my executive assistant, you need to be built for. You need to be built. Because we work at 4 o'clock in the morning. We don't have time. We don't have anything like work is finished for the day. We don't do. In my office, 9 to 5, it does not exist. 9 to 5. You see, in my work, in my line of work, it doesn't exist. We work 24 hours. Anytime. So you're like, I can't do that one. That's why you're not working with me. Because you can't handle it. But there are people who can handle it because they are built for that. I said, they're what? They are built for that. So you aren't built for that. So don't go. So anyway, let's go back into the word. Hallelujah. I'm just dealing with some matters. Amen. Because I perceive some. Okay. Now, Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus, bless the Lord. Jesus. So John and Peter and James were taken. Now here's the thing. Peter became the head of the ministry after Jesus was done. Now when Jesus gave Peter the job, he said, Peter, feed my sheep. Peter, feed my lambs. Peter, feed my sheep. And then after he gave him, Peter was wondering, I am getting the top job. I thought John was going to get it. So he's wondering, I get the top job. I am now this leader of fresh anointing and wisdom ministry. Bishop has left everything to me. But Bishop was very close with this person. So Peter feels he asks. He says, Jesus, could you tell me what is the assignment of John? And that's when you know Jesus has many sides. And Jesus gave him what we call back talk. Jesus said, if I decide that John never dies and stays on the earth until I come the second time, what business is it of yours? So Jesus actually dealt with John for poking his nose in other people's business. You are not doing the job that you're supposed to do. The job that you're used to do in the ministry, you ain't doing it. And then you're putting your mouth on other people's jobs. You're not putting your mouth. The job that you're supposed to do in the body of Christ, the job that you're supposed to do in destiny, the job that you're supposed to do for God, you're not doing. And then you're putting your mouth. Jesus said, listen, stick to your job. Stick to your job. Because the job that John had was that John was going to get the book of Revelation. And he did not tell Peter because it was not Peter's business. And John made sure he put that in the Bible. He made sure everybody knew that Peter was in the flesh. And then he added, he said, that is why there is a rumor that I will never die. But I am the disciple that Jesus loved. You see this? You see this? That's what John put. I am the disciple that Jesus loved. He put it there. Oh my goodness. He put it there. So you need to understand this. But here's the thing. Peter and John, even though this thing was going on in the background, they were destiny partners. They were destiny colleagues. And the Bible says, he says, there was a man who sat at the gate called Beautiful, who would always ask for alms. And one day Peter and John were on their way to prayer. And the man looked at them and he says, can I have alms from you? But Peter and John look insane. And Peter was the spokesman. He said, silver and gold have I none, but such as we have, give I unto you. Take up your bed and walk. And the man leaped up. So you see that Peter and John have come to an alignment that the power can flow through them, that the anointing can flow through them. So you may have a Peter, you may have a John. Both of you have different personalities. Peter was a bit rough. John was a bit very soapy. I mean, he didn't have to say, I am the disciple that Jesus loved. Are you acting like a woman? You're trying to emphasize that Jesus loves you more than all of us. What is this? What kind of personality is this? But Peter was very much the opposite. But these two opposites were supposed to work together. You see, because sometimes you have a person that you're supposed to work with, but God will cause the person you work with to not be like you. You want everybody to be like you. But God joins different people together so that they can do greater things together. So you need to understand who your destiny is with. So we have people who, they want everybody to be same like them. They can only work with people who are a cookie cutter, same personality, same kind of talk, same this thing. So they are very feelings oriented, very, hey girl, how you doing? What's up, girl? What's up, what's up, what's up? Okay, that's fine. But the other person that you're supposed to work with is not a what's up type of girl. She is a what? She's a cerebral type of girl who does not do hey girl. So because she doesn't do hey girl, did the Bible say she must do hey girl? Find me the scripture. Did the Bible say thou must do hey girl? If thou does not do hey girl, thou art a sinner. Is that in the Bible? So she doesn't do hey girl, and when you say hey girl, she says hi. That's finished. You say, what's up? Say, I'm good. But you say, hey, tell me what's going on. I'm fine. And you think, then the person who has the feelings says, you have a problem. Because you're not relating with me well. You're not, you're not relating with me. Because I said, hey, and you didn't say, hey, back. Jesus. Oh my goodness. We're not the same. We're not called to be the same. And you'll never fulfill destiny if you only work with people who are the same. Because here's the thing. For God to create things special, different ingredients have to be put in the pot. How can you make an omelette just made of egg? How can you make a soup just made of water? Water is the part of every soup. But I have a water soup. What do you put in it? Water. What? It has to be made of what? Different ingredients. So different ingredients have to mix together to create something great. You are one of the ingredients. So you need to learn to work with different people. Let me tell you, the ingredient of Bishop Thomas and the ingredient of prophetess, even though we are made of the same type of prophetic material, we're definitely two different ingredients. Oh my Lord. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Prophetess can walk into a room. Hallelujah. She can walk into the room. Everything is packed in the room, neat in the room. And she say, the room feels stuffy. Why is it, does she feel stuffy? Because in the cupboard, something is not packed properly. But when she walks in, she can feel it. Me. There can be a pile of clothes like Mount Everest on top of it. It affected me at all. Rabashakatana. I mean, I'm talking about the pile of clothes could reach up to the roof. I said to the roof, I will look at it, I say, hello, clothes. I sit down, I do what I have to do. She will be like, I can't function. I can't function. I can't function. Me, I will function. So, we're different. We're what? We're different. Oh, can I preach to somebody? So what happens with people want you to be like them. I am not like you. Don't want to be like you. Don't intend to be like you. I like me. And I respect you. So don't change me. And I'm going to try to change you. But do not accuse me because I'm not like you. Jesus. Ooh. I said, do not accuse me because I'm not like you. So a lot of people do that. So a lot of people cannot have mature relationships because everybody must be like them, cackle like them, giggle like them, act like them. Jeez. Hi. Not possible. Not possible. Jeez. Jesus. And if you don't giggle like them, there's a problem. Jesus, help us. Okay, now, so what happened? We can see that the disciples of Jesus were of different personalities, yet all of them formed a team that brought the destiny of the church into reality. So when God brings teams, he brings people who are different. I've come to prophesy to somebody that you're about to leave somebody that's different, but the person is divine. They are divinely different because your destiny partners will be divinely different than you. You don't need another copy of you. You need somebody who's divinely different. Somebody that has what you don't have, will see what you don't see, because every person has a blind spot. But if you have a team, you can have a team of people, and there's no weakness in a team. In an individual, there's a weakness, but you can have a team, and there is no weakness. And the team that Jesus put together, there was no weakness. There was John, who had the compassion to look after his mother. There was Peter, that had the rugidity to face the Pharisees and lead. You see, John did not have the rugidity. John did not have the ruggedness. He was Mr. Sensitive. He was a sensitive soul.
soul while Peter was a rugged soul. So the rugged and the sensitive had to come together for destiny to be fulfilled. But I've come to preach to somebody that you want people who are made in your own image. And if your friends are not in your image, if the people you work with are not in your image, you've got a problem. Grow up, Madam Caterpillar. Grow up, Brother Caterpillar. And be grow up. Somebody say grow up. Somebody say what? Grow up. You got to grow up. This is a problem across the body of Christ. It's a major problem. And in this day and this hour, when God is aligning people, there are people who, some people cannot align with people of different cultures. They can't align with people of different cultures. They can't align with people of different cultures. Everybody they align with must have their accent, must have their accent, and eat the same food. So if God sends you a divine conduction that uses chopsticks, you will not be able to relate, because you can't handle somebody who functions with chopsticks. Bless the Lord. My God. Let's read this scripture. Getting ready to wind up. Romans chapter 12 verse 3. It says, "For I say through the grace that is given to me to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but soberly as God has dealt to each of you a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we being many are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another." The Bible says we are members one of another. That means you are, before you came, you were already connected with some people. So you are connected before you were born. When you come on earth, you have to find the connections that you are connected with before you were born. So your connections were determined before you were born. Jesus. So that's why when they say connect with your divine connections, because divine connections existed before you were born. So before you were sent to the earth, you were already connected with a group of people. That is why you can meet somebody and you meet them today, but it's like you've known them all your life. Because you know why? Your spirit knows them. There is information you have about them, which you wonder, how do I know so much about them? Because your spirit knows them. Because in eternity, you are already connected. Hey, hallelujah. Definitely. My spirit knew this woman before she came to the earth. Shavada basai. Izadabada. Low precious. My spirit knew. My spirit knew this church. My spirit knew people. This is the secret of destiny. So alignment is aligning with the people you were connected with before you were born. And your spirit will draw you to them. Their personalities are not going to be the same. Some they are chatterbox. Some they're comedians. Some are serious and cerebral. Some are quiet and thoughtful. But you have to work with them what? All. Jesus. Whew. Is somebody growing here? Now, the Lord took me into two visions. So when the scroll of heaven came, I was taken into two visions. The first vision, I saw a vision of a woman whose face was spotted with blemishes and acne. Her face was spotted. In the vision, I was shown this woman. And I said, this is this woman. Her face is spotted with blemishes and acne. And the angel of the Lord told me, he said, the reason why her face is blotted with acne and blemishes is because she refuses to relate with the people that I put in her life who have the knowledge to take it away. He said, there are people in her life who have the knowledge to take away her blemishes.
But she refuses to relate with them. So her blemishes will remain, even though she's asking God to remove the blemishes. So she's asking God, remove these blemishes. But he's already provided the people. So she has to relate with the people. So the angel of God was showing me that people do not understand. You see, that what they see in the spirit cannot come into natural because they don't know how to relate. If you don't know how to relate, your destiny will not be fulfilled. You see, there are three things that you cannot afford not to be good at. Don't you ever say, I'm not good with relationships. You better become good relationships or your destiny will not be fulfilled. Everybody was made to be good at relationships. Okay? They say, I'm not good with people. That's a demon. Everybody was good with people. God made everybody to be good with people because your destiny cannot be fulfilled without people. Destiny, your destiny was given to you with a group of people. So you cannot fulfill the destiny without those people participating in your destiny, you participating in theirs. There is a mutual participation in each other's destiny. Jesus participated in the destinies of the 12 apostles. The 12 apostles participated in his destiny. Jesus participated in the destiny of Lazarus, Mary Magdalene, and Mary Magdalene participated in his destiny. This is how God made it. There is a mutual participation. There's a mutual participation. Except the mutual participation comes, destiny is not fulfilled. If you're like, what about what is mine? You're a fool. Let me just tell you, you're a fool. You're a fool. You don't know how this thing works. You say, but I understand. What? Let me explain. Let me tell you why you're a fool. Because when God gives you a destiny, he gives you a destiny with people and also for people. So what you have is not for you. It's for somebody else. So it's not yours. It's why Paul said, I am a debtor. What does it mean? God gave Pastor Juanita a musical gift that can usher in the presence of God. What Pastor Winna needs to understand that she is a debtor. She owes us that gift. I owe you deliverance. I owe you deliverance because you are bound, but guess what? I have an anointing to deliver you. I owe you deliverance. Minister Kerry has an anointing to play the keyboard and usher in the presence of God. He owes us that. He owes. It's a debt. Jesus. Let me take you to the scripture. Because Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. Jesus. We are too selfish, but today selfishness is dying. Somebody says selfishness dies. Woo-hoo. Oh, hallelujah. Romans chapter 1. Okay. Hallelujah. Reading from verse 11. Romans chapter 1, verse 11. Well, from verse 10. It says, making request, if by means at any length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come to you, church in Romans. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift, to the end that you may be established. that is that I may be comforted together with you by our mutual faith, both of you and me. He said, what you need to understand, I have a gift to give you, but even though I have a gift to impart to you, when I impart the gift to you, my faith is going to be stimulated and your faith is going to be stimulated. So there's a mutual participation here. There's a mutual comforting here. Then he says that now I would not have you ignorant that oftentimes I purposed to come to you, but was hindered, that I may bring some fruit among you, also as among the Gentiles. Then he said, I am a debtor both to the Jews and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also, he says, I am in debt to you. So when you have a gift, you are in debt. So when you're in debt, it is not yours. So that's why if you get caught up in selfishness, you will never fulfill destiny. Because destiny is not about you. You are a vessel. Selfish people do not fulfill destiny. It is impossible, because the destiny system is not selfish. And here's the way. You cannot be a billionaire and be selfish. You cannot be a multimillionaire businessman and be selfish. You cannot. Because you have customers by sharing what you have. If Colonel Sanders was selfish, God gave him the recipe of a nice chicken. He says, I'll keep it for myself and my family. The whole world would have lost KFC, Kentucky Fried, holy chicken. Bless the Lord. We would have lost that. But he knew. He said, this recipe that God gave me, it cannot be just for me. It cannot be just for my family. I have to share it with the world. And he shared his chicken with the world. And the world is a better place for KFC. Amen. You can tell I like KFC. I do. Bless the Lord. In fact, we can have a discussion on the best tasting KFC in the world. I can actually give you I can describe to you the molecular structure of the different KFCs in different parts of the world, and how the taste differs from this place to that place to place. In fact, the best KFC I had was in High Point, because there they had a KFC barbecue and I ate KFC chicken livers. You see now. You see, because you see, some of you are thinking, wow, yes, there's a part in North Carolina where they have soul food. So they have soul flavored KFC. After church on Sunday, I just go there, I pay for eat all you can all you can eat. Woo, they have eat all you can KFC. Have you ever heard of that? Oh Lord, I go to that place. Woo! Hallelujah. As I'm approaching this place, I start singing, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. So, I am blessed by what God gave Colonel Sanders. It has brought many a song out of me. And when I was a bachelor, it helped me eat. When you are a bachelor, you don't have a woman. And Sunday, you're used to eating good food. You thank God for Colonel Sanders, who gives you eat all you can KFC. With KFC chicken livers. I tell you, Ramasakaya. Woo! Those livers make you speak in tongues. Made me speak in tongues. Bless the Lord. So what am I saying? So let's go back to the vision. The vision is this. Is I saw this woman, she had blemishes, and the Lord said, there are many people who do not relate with others for their blemishes to be removed. Some of you have the blemish of poverty, the blemish of anger, the blemish. Some of you have physical blemishes. I mean, some of you don't know how to dress. I mean, you really need to take a course. Now, here's the thing what God did. God made sure that when he made people, nobody has everything. And because nobody has everything, and nobody knows everything, and nobody is good at everything, he made the system that for you to be complete, you have to humble yourself to receive a solution for somebody else. One of the reasons why I accomplish so much, guess what? I humble myself to receive help. I receive help from my executive assistant. I receive help from my wife. I receive help from my staff because there's some things I ain't good and I tell them I ain't good at this. Because I know the system. God did not, every person that God made, God intentionally made you with weakness so that you must relate with humility for that weakness to be solved. So if you don't humble yourself, the weakness would open up a door in your life to cause you misery. And the only way that weakness can be closed is by humility. So without humility, the weakness will not be shut. You say, I'm praying for God to handle my weakness. You pray until your teeth fall off. No, the weakness will not be handled. Because that weakness, you need somebody in your life who will cover that weakness for you, and you relate with them, and they provide the strength in the area where you're weak. That's how God created the system. It's a system. It's a system. That is why everybody who's a know-it-all, you know they're a liar, because there's no know-it-all. Anybody who's a have-it-all, you know there's a liar. You know there are skeletons in their closet. Anybody who's a know-it-all, have-it-all, been there, done there, got the t-shirt, there are big, fat skeletons in your closet. Anybody who says, I've got it together, have it together, we know, liar, liar, pants on fire. Because God created the system that nobody has it together. Nobody does. The people that have it together are people who have a team around them to cause them to have it together. Jesus. And guess what? You're not going to have it together if the people who God has sent to help you in the area of your weakness, you're rude to them. Because they ain't staying. And they leave you in your weakness. And you pray for somebody else and God says, that's the person I have. And they go now. Where God says, well, you better humble yourself and eat humble pie and go back. Because that's the person I sent. And if you don't get the help from that person, ain't got anybody else. There's nobody else. And changing the system to accommodate your pride and your arrogance. Jesus. Somebody do this. Say, the bishop is giving us some flogging today. Holy Ghost flogging. I'm giving you in alignment. This is called prophetic flogging. Prophetic flogging. It's called prophetic flogging. Prophetic flogging. Shakata basaya. Yeah. There are different types of messages. This is a message to get you into alignment. Somebody say, I'm getting into alignment. Last, and then we'll finish. Last vision. I had a second vision. I saw a vision of a fully functioning car. A fully functioning car. But the car had no wheels. And when the car had no wheels, the angels began to speak to me. He says, relationships are the wheels of destiny. He said, the first wheel is relationships that cover you, mentor you, and develop you. That's the first wheel. Jesus. Woo! That's the first wheel. That's relationships. So I saw a car fully loaded, but no wheels, so can't go anywhere. fully loaded, petrol in the tank, engine ready, but no wheels. So the car can go nowhere. See, there's some of you are going nowhere because you go on the wheels of relationship. You say, I go on the wheels of God. Okay. Okie dokie. Okay. You go on the wheels of God. Yes. Well, the way God works, God is in heaven. And God, hallelujah, he brings help to you through who? Human beings. People. So he does. So when you say, all I need is Jesus. Yes. All you need is Jesus. But the way Jesus supplies your need is through who? People. So if you don't receive the help of Jesus to people, you're a car without wheels. And many people listening to me, you're a car without wheels. Because you don't know how to relate with people. You want to control and manipulate everybody to be in your order. That ain't working. Okay. Okay, so number one. He said the first will are relationships that cover you, mentor you, and develop you. I have those relationships. They cover me, they mentor me, and they develop me. Hallelujah. And my staff know, church knows, my spiritual father, and I'm mentored, I'm developed, I'm coached. They mentor me, develop me. Number two, the second wheel. So some people, they have the first wheel. But how many of you know you can't drive the car with one wheel? Huh? Are you with me? Okay. The second wheel is the wheel of people who do what? Support you. They are your supporters. They could be your mother, your sister. They're supporters. They could be supporters. They support you. They don't participate in it, but they support you. They could support you with finances, support you with encouragement, support you with prayer. So the second set are supporters. Now, a lot of people make the mistake, they think your mentor is your supporter. Your mentor is to cover you and develop you. They're not your supporter. Because your supporter, if you fall down, will say, oh, you still look nice when you were doing it. You were singing. It was a nice song, you know. You really sang it well. But the mentor will say, you missed two chords. And you've been missing these two chords for the last three Sundays. You need to get yourself, step to the next level. You say, but you hurt me because you don't sound like my supporter. Supporters bring comfort. Mentors bring change. So, you see, some people, you see, they don't know how to relate. But I'm preaching to you this so you can learn. Oh, my God. So, you see, when you're relating with somebody, you need to know the category of the relationship. So the people who, they want you to be supporter. But you are not supporter, you are mentor, coverer, developer. A supporter is there to stroke you, to say, it's all right, it's all right. I'm with you, you are nice. Forget that mistake. Everybody needs that. That's it. You are nice. Oh my God. When you preached, it was good. Oh Lord, Lord, that was good. And then the mentor says, that scripture that you explained, you did not explain it properly. But you think, but everybody said I was good. Wait, now you say, I made a mistake. Now, I don't understand this. This is because the person is not your supporter. Some of you only want everybody to be my supporter. I don't take any correction. I don't take any development. If you want to correct me, I get offended. That means you will never have one will. That means one wheel of your destiny will always be off. If you don't have people who will correct you, chastise you, and flog you. Sometimes you need a good Holy Ghost flogging from a mentor to get you back on track. Jesus. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Bless the Lord. My sons and daughters, I've got a news flash for you. I'm not your supporter. News flash! Bishop Thomas is not your supporter. Woo, glory be to God. I'm your mentor, coverer, and developer. I have my own. Amen? Jesus. I got some mentorship yesterday. I was telling my wife, she said, okay, you need to understand that, because I was so dealing with myself this morning, early hours of the morning, she said, but you need to understand, these men have been doing this for a while. I said, boy, this area is very lacking in my life. Very lacking. And she knows I'm a bit of an extremist, so I was now going in it very extremely. So she tried to say, because she is a supporter. So she's like, okay, take it now. Take it easy now. Take it easy. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Now, here's the thing. Do you know, with the first wheel and the second wheel, you can move the car. But the car will not go far. Because with the first two wheels, because if your car is front engine drive, it will drag. But my God, it won't go far. It will make the most horrific noise. But if it's a front engine, it's a front engine drive, it will actually propel. And because the back wheels do not have, are not tied to the engine. Oh, I'm teaching you something today. You thought the bishop didn't know about mechanics. I can talk about it, but I can't do it. Oh. But I can talk. Say the bishop can talk. So we're now going to do a class on mechanics, automobile engineering. So there are three types of engines. There is front wheel drive engines that when the engine is activated, it moves the front wheels. So it's a front wheel powered car. Then you have cars which are, and a front wheel car kind of give you more of a luxury experience. And then you have like luxury cars like the BMW, which are driver based cars, which are back wheel driven. That means the back wheel is what is propelled and the front wheel does not, it's actually this follows. And when you have a back wheel car, it's called a driver's car because it gives you more control. It gives you the ability to do more maneuvers because the back wheel is what is powered by the engine. And then you have the third type of car, which is the four-wheel drive, which is one that when you are stuck, it's called the all-wheel drive, which is for all vehicle terrain. That means in every type of terrain, in sand, in dust, in hills, that all four wheels are powered. But when you have all four wheels, there's a particular luxury effect that you don't get. There's a particular comfort that you don't get. There's a particular type of drive that you do not get in an all-wheel drive. That's where you have cars that have the ability to switch from all-wheel drive to front-wheel drive. Or some cars like the BMW SUV can give you the ability to switch from all-wheel drive system to a back-wheel drive system. Bless the Lord. This is your lesson in the dynamics of engines. Amen. Bless the Lord. Okay. Hallelujah. Okay. Now, these are how engines operate. Now, let's talk about the third wheel. What is the third wheel? Some say the third wheel. Because for some of you, some people have the first wheel and the second wheel. If you have the first wheel and the second wheel, You can have some movement. But there's a third wheel. He said the third wheel of relationships is the relationships that collaborate with you and partner with you. Those are the people that you work with. They are not your supporters. Because if you don't do your job right, if he is playing the keyboard, then the drums are not working, you look and say, I mean, what's up? You are affecting my flow. The person says, but you don't sound like my mama. You're not as soft as my mama. You say, I ain't your mama. Right now, we're supposed to play together. And right now, you're supposed to hit the chord right and the chord and right. So right now, we are working together. So the third wheel are people who do what? Work together. Those are your colleagues in destiny. They're what? Your partners in destiny. These are the people that you work with. Without them, there's no destiny. That's your Peter, John, Thomas, Andrew, all the apostles, Paul and Silas, Paul and Barnabas. These are all people that you work with. Work with. Luke, Timothy, Titus. These are all a group of destiny relationships that you work with. Work with. So you have work with. Work with. So that's the third wheel. The third wheel. Someone said the third wheel. Now, if you have all three wheels, the car will move. But you still have some problems. It will be lopsided. Oh my God, it will be a kind of lopsided car and the police will stop you. You'll be stopped for damaging the road. And then there's the fourth wheel. The fourth wheel are the people your solution is for. They are the people you're called to. They're the people you're called to. So the people they're supposed to serve your solutions with. So there are four types of relationships, which are the four wheels of destiny. Each one of you, you need to know where is there a deficiency. Every one of you is listening to me. The Holy Spirit came upon me today to preach his message to you. You need to do a box and put in that box. If the box is blank, you need to start saying, God, show me who covers me, mentors me, and develops me. Who is my supporter? Because I need some supporters. Okay? Because sometimes you go to your mentor and all you want is you just want to be able to somebody to say, it is all right. It is good. It is this nice. It's good. But then you go to the mentor and the mentor is like, rise up. Because that's the language of the mentor. So what you need is a supporter. But your mentor is not your supporter. And your supporter is not your mentor. Your supporter cannot mentor you into destiny. Your supporter is a supporter. And then you have your colleagues. Your colleagues are not your mentors. Your colleagues, some people are so foolish. They listen to colleagues who are on the same level as they are to get advice to go to higher level. Jesus help us. You are relating with somebody who's on the same level as you are to how to go to a higher level. How can that work? It cannot work. Jesus. And then, after you have all of this, there's the fourth wheel. Now, the fourth wheel is what makes the car drive. Without the fourth wheel, the car will not drive. The car will not have speed. The car will not have progress. What's the fourth wheel? Who you're sent to. For me, people who are in bondage. If you're in bondage, I was sent for you. If you're bound, I was sent for you. I was made for you to take you out of that bondage. Not just to take you out of the bondage, but to take you on a journey from bondage to greatness. So we are together for life. I'm going to be in your life until you live life. And when we get to heaven, you still see me. Because we're connected by destiny. I said, we're connected by destiny. This is alignment. So when you come into a real alignment, you align with worship And then from the worship, you align with your destiny. And then you align with what? The four wheels of destiny. Now, these four wheels would remove every blemish from your life. For the blemishes to be removed from your life, you need these four wheels. Oh my God. Jesus had these four. You said, who are those? The person that covered Jesus and launched him into the ministry was John. John did that. John was his covering. He came under the ministry of John. And when John died, Jesus withdrew himself. And what Jesus said about John was so awesome. He said, who was John? They said he was a prophet. He says, if you can handle this, he's the Elijah that was said all to come. He says, of all men born of a woman, there's no one greater than John. That means Jesus gave John maximum order. And guess what? He was born of a woman. So Jesus was actually inferring, out of respect, that John was greater than him. Oh, you didn't hear that? Because he was giving him respect, honor. He said, of all those born of a woman, was he not born of a woman? Or was he born of an angel? He was born of a woman. So Jesus was giving John respect and honor. Because that was his covering that opened up his destiny. Then Jesus had his supporters. Who were Jesus' supporters? Who can tell me? His mother and the woman that followed him. Mary Magdalene, Lazarus, Mary and Martha. What do you think Jesus went to Mary's house and Lazarus' house for? To preach? No. To relax. Because when he went there, Martha was preparing what? Food. Jesus went to the house for some TLC. Some of you, the reason why you are so stressed out, you have not got TLC for the last 2 years. No TLC. Nobody has this loved on you. They say, what do you want? Let me fix something for you. Let's just make you comfortable. Let's relax. You are suffering from acute TLC deficiency syndrome. That's a new sickness. What's it called? Acute TLC deficiency syndrome. You are hyperventilating because you have not had any TLC for the last 2 years. You just get stress. You go home, stress. You go to work, stress. You just need somebody to just say, it is cool. Relax. Just be. Just be. I mean, just be. But here's the thing. When you don't have that, or I'm going to help somebody today, you expect the other three relationships to do that for you. That is why relationships get messed up, because people expect, these are my relationships, they must be you. You'll be my mentor, my supporter. Also, what else? Tell me. I'm seeing if the group here remembers. My mentor, my what? Supporter, guess what? My colleagues, and guess what? The people, okay, my customer, the customer of my gift. So there's the customer of your gift. Who is the customer of your anointing? So when people don't get that, they expect one person to be all, or a group of people to be all of that to you. Oh, Jesus. Even Jesus didn't have that. Because Jesus never went to the apostles' houses for relaxation. The only person's house he went to eat some good food was Peter's mother, who rose up. She was sick. Jesus made so she woke up so he can eat some nice food. I understand Jesus. I myself, I will raise her from the dead. Bless the Lord. Hey, bless the Lord, man. Woo! Every person needs T TLC. I'm asking you, when is the last time you got some TLC? Some of you think, dude, I'm under demonic attack. I feel so stressed. No, it's no demon. No TLC for the last 3 years. You are suffering from lack of TLC. No tender loving care. Somebody say, God sent me some TLC. Oh Lord. Woo-hoo. Everybody needs that. I remember there's a time in my life, God sent a woman, Mama Myong. She was 73 years old. So, obviously, at that time I was 30 something. And God sent her just to give me some TLC. She would say, Andre, when you come to Tampa, don't go to a hotel. Just come to my house and I will look after you. And I said, Mama Mia, I'm a wise man. I am coming. Because at that time, I was suffering from acute, majorly acute, doubly acute, acute, TLC deficiency syndrome. Bless the Lord. And Mama Myung would cook some delicious Korean food for me. And we'd go from restaurant to restaurant. And we'd just talk. And we'd just chill. And I just enjoyed being with her. She had led 12,500 people to Jesus. When she walked into a room, love walked into the room. She had a tangible love anointing. So I was in the presence of love. Now let me tell you, God was smart. I'm telling you, I needed that woman. Jesus. I was under stress. I needed what? Some TLC. Praise the Lord. Whew. Can somebody shout amen? So some of you, that's what you need. So you say, what do you like to eat? So God knows what I like. What you like will be different. But God knows what you like, what you just make you feel comfortable, you just relax and just chill and just be. You need that. Now, a lot of people want every relationship with you to give you that. And then you get vexed when the relationship doesn't give you. But you lack relationship wisdom. Then Jesus had another will, which was who? His colleagues. Who were his colleagues? Peter, James, and John. They were what? His disciples. Did he ever go to them for support? Did he go to them for mentorship? But guess what? Do you know you spend the most time with colleagues? Because colleagues are where you do your destiny with colleagues. But you don't expect to get support from colleagues and expect to get mentorship from colleagues. And then who was Jesus assigned to? Who? The masses, the multitudes. Did Jesus go to the multitudes for comfort? Do you know there are ministers who actually look to the congregation they preach to, everybody preach to, for love back? So if the congregation gives their love back, they get vexed. No. Minister, the congregation is the fourth wheel, not the second wheel. Oh, but this is deep. I said the congregation is the fourth wheel, not the second wheel. I got my first wheel people. I got my second wheel people. I got my third wheel people. And I got my fourth wheel people. I got it all lined up. Ooh. Somebody say, I'm going to get it lined up like you, Bishop. I'm going to get it lined up like you, Bishop. Thank you for this preaching. I'm going to get it lined up like you, Bishop. My God. Oh, Lord. And by the way, your wife or your husband or your mother or your father cannot be all four. So don't even try. You will actually affect the relationship Because you put too much pressure on the relationship. For the relationship to fulfill aspects of you. Because all of us, we have four voids. Each of you have four relationship voids for these four things. Jesus. I'm preaching better than you're amening. I said, you need to amen in church. You need to amen in your house. Now I'm going to take my phone. Anybody who's getting me, I want you to text it. I'm looking. I want you to say, Bishop, I'm getting it. I'm getting it. I'm getting it. Because now we're going to pray for you. Hallelujah. I'm now going to pray for the Spirit of the Lord to touch you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to text on Facebook, text on YouTube. This is a prophetic act. Say, I receive that anointing. I'm getting it, Bishop. 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 Oh, hallelujah. I'm getting it, Bishop. I'm getting it, Bishop. I'm getting it. Is somebody getting this revelation? I'm getting it. I'm getting it. I'm getting it, 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 I'm getting it. Jesus. It's time for spiritual alignment. Let's stand up. Shivara. Let's start to worship Him. Is somebody getting it? Somebody getting it? Shia bara bara going to pray for everybody that the grace of God will come upon you, that you get into worship alignment, that you get into destiny alignment, that you get into alignment, alignment, alignment with your relationships. There's an anointing for that today. They start to cry out to God because His grace is going to be released. Je baraba sore bebe, je baraba sore bebe, je frebe bebe shibebe. We bata bata bebe shibebe. Jesus. Hallelujah. Just lift up your hands today. I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, I pray for the release of grace, alignment, spiritual alignment grace. Worship alignment grace. Mission alignment grace. Relationship alignment grace. In the name of Jesus. Relationship alignment grace. Relationship alignment grace. Relationship alignment grace. Relationship alignment grace. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Relationship alignment grace. In the mighty name of Jesus. Today I don't sense to prophesy. Today what I give you is a prophecy in itself. I tell you by the Spirit, God is going to be working in the next 24 hours. to begin to speak to you and deal with you on worship, on mission, and on relationships. You need to feel the four wheels of relationship. And if it's not filled, the Holy Ghost needs to speak to you and put people in their categories. You need to put people in their categories. Hallelujah. My sons and daughters, I'm going to be asking you, who are in your four categories? Who are in your categories? In the name of Jesus. Tomorrow, hallelujah, we have a prophetic and deliverance service. On Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, we have our online conference. And then on Sunday, woo, we're back in church. We're going to call the service Holy Ghost Bonfire. Holy Ghost Fire. It's a service of what? Holy Ghost Fire. There's going to be a Holy Ghost Bonfire. Hey, Shakatai. Prophetic day of fire. Are you with me? Prophetic day of fire. Amen. Hallelujah. We give you glory.